Okay, we are continuing with a series of talks on Swami Vivekananda. Now this particular series is already creating a lot of enthusiasm worldwide, and we are getting very positive response from the series we did on Sri Ramakrishna. So now we are continuing this series with a talk on the chief disciple of Sri Ramakrishna, this fireball that he fired to the west, and the name is Vivekananda. You see, the last talk I said that Swami Vivekananda has now arrived in India with a one-way ticket. This is how his disciples trusted him, that he'll do well in the West, and they'll buy him a return ticket sooner or later. This is how the poor man was sent off to America. And the struggles he had no credentials until the professor of Harvard University gave him the highest credentials. Here is a man more learned than all the professors of Harvard put together, says the Harvard professor. Just imagine the dynamism of this man. He was able to influence one person by just 1 hour talk to give such credential that here is a person more learned than all our professors put together. See the comprehensive understanding and depth of understanding of Swami Vivekananda and how he can impress audiences. So now he's entered the parliament religion. Before I continue with the story, let me tell you the motivation of this Vivekananda for going to the West. You may be surprised. You may think here is the godman of India, modern India. He's of course going to go there to start a movement, to get people, to get devotees to come and sit at his feet and start some kind of new movement under his name, nothing of the sort. The reason why Vivekananda was driven to go to the West was not spirituality. He didn't want to say, oh, I'm going to talk spiritual. He said very bluntly, the reason why I went to the West is to find, if you like, get some bread for my people. Simple as that, honest as that. Not teaching spirituality, no. I want to do something for my poor people who are struggling, who don't have a piece of bread to eat. For us to talk of metaphysics and philosophy and religion when they are starving, when they can't get clean drink of water, is like slapping somebody on the face. We will not do that. The first priority is to make sure their material well-being is taken care of. And for that to happen, I am going to go to the West and plead with those people to help my people. That was his cry, begging for his people. Do you know what he said? He said, I will go, and what little I have, which he thought is very little, this thing called spirituality, I'm going to dish it out to the West, and in return ask for physical help, technological help, which will help my poor people. This was the driving force of Vivekananda to go to the West. See, pragmatism, it is so crucial. Sometimes in the name of religion we forget to be practical and pragmatic. You cannot teach philosophy to starving humanity. You must take care of their material needs first before you talk of higher ideas or higher ideals. And that you must stop, you must recognize. And this person went for that. He would have sold his soul if that would have helped India. That is what he went to do, to sell himself, to get some money back. He was selling his soul in order to get some physical help. Again, you know, this reminds me of one of the major majestic personality of ancient India who did the same. You know the person? Ramanujacharya, the founder of the philosophy that is at the back of, say, the Swaminarayan movement today. This Ramanuju said, if I can help 50, 100, 200 people get salvation and in the process I go to hell, I don't mind. It's good accounting. You say, I'm a Gujarati, so I like to do these accounts. If 50 people can be helped and one person goes down, it's good equation. It's good business sense. And in fact, that is what Ramanujacharya stands for. The reason why, out of all the acharyas, I love Ramanujacharya is precisely for this reason. A heart of gold, breath of, you know, this love of humanity is the thing that draws me. And this is visible in Vivekananda. He didn't go there to start a movement in his name and say, okay, all of you start a new ashram and here I am, sit in the middle of you and you sit at my feet. He went there to sell himself, kill himself, to get some material help for his people. That was his project. You see the honesty of this man. So here he is now. And you see what happens, as I said in the last talk, he gave his first address, he stood up, and he uttered those five magic words at the parliament. First in the morning, he was nervous to get on the stage. He kept avoiding, because he said, all these other representatives of 10 religions have come with such lovely, lovely, well-written speeches, such ornamental speeches. I have prepared nothing. I'm an idiot. He was kicking himself. I'm an idiot. I have not prepared anything. And they come with such flowery language to represent their religions. I got nothing. And then he said, I took the name of Saraswati. He said, oh, mother, sit at the tip of my lip, in the tongue, and let it flow. And he stood up and came to the front. And those five magic words, sisters and brothers of America, have become immortalized by Swami Vivekananda. You may think, is it just because he's using, you know, different vocabulary instead of saying ladies and gentlemen, you know, the standard, the Western kind of way of addressing audiences, he's using the word sisters. Oh, what's this kind of, that's the only reason. No, let me tell you what actually happened. The West had never seen a God-man amongst themselves. They've heard of a God-man. They strongly adhere to the idea of Christianity and Christ as a God-man, but they had never seen a God-man amongst themselves. Here for the first time, right in the heart of the, he came in the middle of them and uttered these words, and the words carry the power. You see, whenever a person is talking about spirituality from experience, the words carry tremendous power. Do you know what is recorded? Few thousand people. Look, here is an unknown monk standing on the stage for the first time, just saying simple five words. And there is no loudspeaker, by the way, at that time. Electricity had just been discovered. So he just has to shout to 5,000 people or 3,000 people in the audience. And these words carried tremendous dynamism. It made everybody stand up and start applauding. And I checked it up. It's recorded. They applauded for 2 minutes. Now, this is not minor. Test it out. When you go to any good talks, when a very good speaker speaks, and then at the end you actually time yourself regarding how long people applaud, you'll be lucky to get 5 seconds. 2 minutes, it means getting out of hand. They're going mad. And people who were sitting there and recorded, we don't know what happened, but when this lad, you know, that's how they call me, when this lad opened his mouth, something drew us, made us stand up and keep clapping without knowing why. And the Hindus have tried to analyze, and this is because sister and brother, there's nothing of the sort, they have no idea. The reason is this, what was hiding in this man, in this spiritual personality, was bursting forth. The spirit that was hiding behind this material frame was bursting forth and expressing itself, showing itself, I am the God-man, and I'm standing in front of you. I'm here for humanity, not for just Hindus. Humanity, I relate to all of you. And that thing reached out and grabbed them and made them stand up. And made him very famous. And the message in the first speech, and again, you see, this is ironic. This speech was given on 9/11. And 9/11 has become immortalized for other reasons. So this speech was given on 9/11, 108 years ago, before this 9/11, exactly 108 years ago. And he had already given a prescription, he had already given a warning of what is to come. Unless these important ideas which are sitting within the Hindu tradition, only in the Hindu tradition, I'd like to insist on that, it's only in the Hindu tradition. Sometimes you like to score points for your religion. You've been meek and mild enough for long enough. We need to somehow stand up. This was lying in the Hindu tradition. He just dished it out. Idea of pluralism. There are many different ways of making spiritual progress. Recognize and allow for it. Give dignity to humanity to unfold spiritually in a way that it suits them. Don't impose your way onto others. This was the speech. And the thing is, immediately, the audience, you see, the thing is this, because it was coming from the heart, it was backed by spiritual experience. He was talking about spirituality from experience. That is tremendous power it carried. And immediately hit the target. And that particular speech, of course, became very famous. And by the way, there is one on the internet, you might find somebody saying, we have discovered the speech of Swami Vivekananda in the parliament. That is not true. I'm telling you, there were no recordings done in the parliament, guaranteed. And this speech, they are, you know, plodding around saying, this is Swami Vivekananda, is actually being introduced by a woman speaker. There's no woman speaker. The women were sitting in the sidelines there. So this is definitely not Swami Vivekananda's voice. But what happened is, I think in the 1920s, somebody did a recording for a radio program. But they tried to kind of copy Swami Vivekananda's speech, so they had an actor, but the actor was pretty good, so his speech is pretty good. So he's doing the round saying, Dilip Bhai, you discovered Swami Vivekananda's speech. I said, no, my friend, it's an actor, but I'm very pleased that you discovered it, and you can listen to it, it's nice. The speech was that dramatic, only 10-minute speech, but it captured the heart of the elite of America. It captured them.